commerce. Give the definitions of joint stock company and cooperatives. What are the differences between them? There are some points of similarity between a cooperative organization and a joint stock company. Both secure capital by sale of share. Both are corporate bodies. According to Horace Plunkett, cooperation is self-help rendered effective by an organization. It is better farming, better business, and better living. Basic of difference. Number one, meaning. Joint stock company. It is an association of persons formed for doing a business with the object of making profit. Cooperative. It is a voluntary association of persons from the weaker section of the society. Its aim is to serve. Number two, number of members. Joint stock company. Minimum is 2 and maximum is 50 in a private company. Minimum is 7 and maximum is unlimited in a public company. Cooperative. Minimum is 25 and maximum number of member is unlimited. Number 3, local membership. Joint stock company. The members of a public limited company belong to different parts of the country and even different countries of the world. Cooperative. The members belonging to the same locality. Number 4, registration. Joint stock company. A company is formed and registered as per the Companies Act of 1956. Cooperative. It is registered as per the Cooperative Societies Act of a state government. Number 5, management. Joint stock company. It is managed by the board of directors elected by the shareholders. Cooperative. All the members, the management of cooperative societies with the help of the board of directors. Number 6, object. Joint stock company. Profit is the primary motto of a joint stock company. Cooperative. Service is the primary motto of a cooperative. Number 7, purchase of shares. Joint stock company. In companies, there is no limit in the purchase of maximum number of shares. Cooperative. In cooperative societies, minimum number of purchase of shares is limited to the extent of utilization of benefits. Number 8, facilities. Joint stock company. Government do not provide any concession. Cooperative. It enjoys concessions like exemption from paying income tax, stamp duty, and registration fee, etc. Number 8, right to vote. Joint stock company. One share, one vote principle is followed. Cooperative. One man, one vote principle is followed. Number 10, repayment of shares capital. Joint stock company. A shareholder cannot get back his capital during the lifetime of the company. Cooperative. A member in a cooperative society can surrender his shares, withdraw his capital. Number 11, profit. Joint stock company. Profit is distributed to the shareholders on the basis of their share value. Cooperative. A minimum portion of the profit is distributed as dividend. Number 12, transfer of shares, joint stock company. The shares are freely transferable in a public limited company, but there are restrictions in private limited company. Cooperative. A member of a cooperative society cannot transfer his shares, but he can surrender his shares. Discuss the merits and demerits of sole trading form of business. The merits of sole trading concern are, number 1, easy formation. Sole proprietorship is the only form of organization where no legal formalities is required, no agreement is required, and registration of the firm is not essential. Anybody willing to start a sole trading concern can do so immediately. Number 2, direct motivation. The entire profit of the business goes to the sole trader. Nobody can claim a share in the profit. It motivates him to expand his business activities. Number 3, flexibility. It is a highly flexible type of organization. The proprietor can adapt, adjust activities of the business to the changing trends and market conditions because the sole trader is the sole owner of his business. Retention of business secrets. A sole trader can maintain business secrets. Being the sole proprietor, he is not expected to share his trade secrets with anybody else. In this form of organization, there is also no need to disclose accounts or any other material facts to the public. Number 5, quick decision. The sole proprietor is his own boss and need not consult others while making any decision. Therefore, he can take quick decision and implement them without any delay. Number 6, increase in sales. A sole trader has direct relationship with the customers. Direct contact with the customers will enable the proprietor to know the nature of their tastes, likes and dislikes. It enables him to make necessary changes in the quality and design of his products. It will boost his sales besides enhancing the reputation of the firm. Number 7, smooth running of business. Since the sole trading concern is a small business, the sole trader appoints only a few employees who are personally known to him, so he can understand their problems easily and able to solve them to their satisfaction. The absence of friction with the employees paves the way for the smooth running of the business. 8. Development of personality. Sole proprietorship facilitates the development of personal qualities like self-reliance, initiative, and independent judgment. Number 9, easy dissolution. A sole trading concern is very easy to dissolve. Whenever a sole trader wants to close his business, he can do so without undergoing any legal formality. Number 10, better coordination. As the size of the business is small, with limited resources, the sole trader can effectively coordinate the activities of the business. Number 1, limited capital. The resources of a sole proprietor are limited. He depends only on his personal resources and his borrowing capacity. The borrowing capacity depends on his assets and credits worthiness. it is obvious that financial resources of a single person will be insufficient for business expansion. Limitation of finance is a major handicap for sole trader business. Therefore, the size of the firm remains small. Limited managerial ability. The managerial ability of a sole trader is limited because a person may not be an expert in each and every field of business, such as purchasing, selling, accounting, etc. The sole proprietor may not be able to use the services of experts for want of resources. The limited managerial capacity may hinder the growth of the business. Unlimited liability. The unlimited liability of a sole proprietor may affect his enthusiasm and restrict introducing novel ideas in business. Short life. Anything which affects the personal life of a sole trader affects his business also. If his children are interested and efficient to run the business, the sole trader business can be continued. Otherwise, it will be closed. Hasty decisions. The chances of wrong decision making are quite high in a sole trader business. This is because of the fact that the sole trader takes all decision of the business himself without any assistance. This may lead to wrong decisions. The hasty decisions may result in loss and affect the sole trader. Lack of specialization. The sole trader has to undertake all the work relating to business himself, such as buying, selling, accounting, financing, advertising, etc. So the benefits of division of labor cannot be reaped, and specialization cannot be achieved in this type of business. Uneconomic size. Because of limited capital and skill, the sole traders have to work on a small scale basis. Thus, he is deprived of economic of large scale operation. Lack of consultation. He has no one else to consult before taking any important decisions except his family members. This may result in heavy loss if his discussions go wrong. Uncertainty. The life of the sole trader business is uncertain and unstable. The life of business depends upon the changes in taste and preferences of customers and changes in fashion and technology. If sole trader fails to cope up with the latest development, he will land in trouble. Risk of entire loss. As the sole trader is the sole owner of the business, he has to bear all losses of his business. Explain the rights and duties of partners. Rights of partners. Every partner has a right to take part in the conduct and management of the business. Every partner has a right to express opinion on any matter related to the firm. Every partner has a right to be consulted before taking important decisions. Every partner has a right to inspect and take copy of books of account and records of the firm. Every partner has the right to an equal share in the profits of the firm unless otherwise agreed by the partners. Every partner has the right to receive interest on loans and advances at the rate of 6% per annum. Every partner has the right to be indemnified for the expenses incurred and losses sustained by him in the ordinary conduct of the firm's business. Every partner has an equal right to use the assets of the firm for its business. No new partner can be admitted into partnership without the consent of the other partners. Every partner has a right to retire from the firm. Duties of partners. The duties of partners can be classified into A. absolute duties and B. qualified duties. A. absolute duties. Absolute duties are fixed by law, which cannot be violated by partners' agreement. These duties are applicable to all partnership. Every partner must act diligently and honestly in the discharge of his duties to the maximum advantage of all partners. Every partner must act in a loyal and faithful manner towards each other. Every partner must act within the scope of the authority entrusted to him. Every partner is bound to share the losses of the firm equally unless otherwise agreed. Every partner must indemnify the firm against loss sustained due to his willful negligence in the ordinary course of the business. No partner can transfer or assign his interest in the firm to others without the consent of other partners. Every partner must maintain and render true and correct accounts relating to the firm's business. No partner can engage himself in a business which is likely to compete with the business of the firm. Every partner should use the firm's property only for the firm's business and interest. No partners can make any secret profit by way of commission on purchases or sales effected on behalf of the firm. B. Qualified duties. Qualified duties given in the Act can be modified by an agreement of partners entered into. R. Bring out the distinction between a company and a partnership. Number one, the Acts. Partnership firm. Partnership firm is governed by the Indian Partnerships Act 1932. Joint stock company. Companies are governed mainly by the provisions of the Companies Act 1956. Two, registration. Partnership firm. Registration with the registrar of firms is only optional. Joint stock company. Registration with the registrar of companies is compulsory. Number three, number of members. Partnership firm. A minimum of 2% is necessary to form partnership. The maximum number is restricted to 10 in the case of banking business and to 20 in the other type of business. Joint stock company. The minimum number of persons required for starting a private limited company is 2 and the maximum is 50. The maximum number of members is 7. And the maximum number is unlimited in public limited company. Liability. The liability of your partner is joint, several and unlimited. Joint stock company. The liability of the joint shareholder is limited. Transfer of funds. Partnership firm. A partner cannot transfer his interest in the firm without the consent of all other partners. Joint stock company. In a public limited company, shares are fully transferable. However, certain restrictions are placed on transfer of shares in the case of private limited companies. Number six, management. Partnership firm. Management of a firm is carried on by all or by any of them acting for all. Joint stock company. It is managed by board of directors elected by the shareholders. Number seven, stability. Partnership firm. A partnership firm is not stable. Joint stock company. A company is stable as it is totally unaffected by any such contingencies. Procedural partnership firm. Both for formation and dissolution, the procedures are simple. Joint stock company. Both the formation and winding up are subject to many legal formalities. Number nine, membership. Partnership firm. In a partnership, only individuals can become its members. Joint stock company. In a company, an institution can also become a member by purchasing its shares. Nature. Partnership firm. Partnership is the relation between persons who have agreed to share the profits or losses of a business. Joint stock company. A company is an artificial person. Number 11, audit. Partnership firm. Audit of accounts is not necessary. Joint stock company. It should be audited by chartered accountant legally, formalities for winding or many. Number 12, dissolution. Partnership firm. It can be dissolved at any time. joint stock company, legal formalities for winding up are many.